I'm John Stillion, Bryan Clark. We were the kind of main folks who worked on this study. Our goal really was to look at battle network competitions from the past and see if we could come up with some lessons that might be applicable to similar sorts of things that are becoming more and more common in warfare in the 21st century. So the main things that we found, or our main insights from the historical studies, were first of all, network attributes depend a lot on your operational metrics. So what you're trying to do is going to drive the sort of network that you ultimately wind up with. So it's really important to pick the right metrics, and Brian's going to give you a really good illustration of that with respect to anti-submarine warfare. Tempo of operations influences the decision to a great extent of whether you want to exploit your adversary's network or simply try to disrupt it. Kind of a quick thumbnail sketch of why that's important is that things like submarine operations, just because of the nature of the platforms, tend to unfold over a period of days or weeks, whereas air operations tend to unfold over a period of hours or minutes. And so disrupting a adversary's network is probably more useful in a tactical and operational sense for air operations, and exploiting the network is more useful just due to the tempo for things like submarine operations. Virtual attrition, which we'll talk more about, particularly, in both cases, turns out to be often more cost effective than just simply trying to attrit all the other guys' platforms. That's kind of an important thing that we, for lack of a better term, have kind of relearned in this study. Over the last 25 years or so, U.S. and allied operations have tended to try to find and kill everything in the battle space because we had the capacity and the capability to do that. That's often not necessary or cost-effective if you're up against a capable, competent adversary. You'll see that we've got some actual locating data on the rate at which competitions, particularly electronic warfare competitions, tend to accelerate as the conflict goes on. They tend to also culminate and then jump to a new mode or a new regime of competition. And then in some cases, and in particular, well, we'll see at least one on both flavors of competition, the air and the submarine. One side or the other is often saved by the bell when a conflict ends. So you may be on the verge of having a competition shift modes that would have kind of sunk the capabilities that one side or the other had sort of built up at great cost and expense over years when a conflict comes to an end. And that's important as well, particularly as you look forward and say, all right, where is this competition likely to culminate and what should we be thinking about doing next kind of things. So having said all that up front, I'm going to turn it over to Brian, and he's going to talk to you about anti-submarine warfare for the next 45 minutes or so, something like that.
So we wanted to look at two different competitions when we did this study, and we wanted to look at ones that are going to have relevance going into the future, in particular dealing with the most challenging sort of high-end warfare threats. And we said two enduring challenges are submarines and the ability to find and negate them, and then also air defenses and how to overcome them. So these two are part of the anti-access area denial capability that a number of countries are pursuing. So we thought that these would be important to look at. Also, they both happen to be about a century old. Air defenses and airplanes, submarines and anti-submarine warfare have been around since the turn of the last century. So we've got about a century's worth of data upon which to base some analysis and conclusions. So one thing we were trying to do with this study was a quantitative approach, and one of the things we wanted to then use is as much data as possible, so that century's worth of data was going to prove useful. In terms of why looking at historical analyses would be important for the future, is we wanted, obviously that's where your data is in historical cases, as opposed to just modeling and simulation, which can be modified and geared however you'd like it based on the assumptions you choose. Historical data is pretty much the record that's happened, and then you can draw some insights from that. Why we thought the submarine case was still relevant today is the fundamentals of the submarine anti-submarine warfare competition are still about the same. submarines are relatively slow, especially compared to the things that they are looking for or that might be looking for them. They have limited situational awareness. Even though we have sonar on submarines, it's still kind of like driving in the blind a little bit, and you don't have a very long range. When you think about the submarine versus a surface ship with, you know, radar and visual and all these other sensors, the submarine's very limited in how quickly it can see something and how quickly it can figure out if that thing is a threat and if it might actually hit them or not. So think about torpedoes as a potential challenge there. You get a torpedo detection. It's going to take some finite amount of time to determine if that torpedo is likely to hit you and then make a decision about whether you choose to evade or not. Whereas on the surface, you very quickly have fire control systems that determine the threat, the nature of it, its trajectory, whether it's likely to hit you. And the last thing is submarines lack self-defense. Even if you think about countermeasures and some other things that might be pursued, they're still pretty limited in their ability to fight off an incoming threat, whereas a ship or an airplane has the ability to shoot missiles or guns or something at the incoming threat and attempt to negate it. So you can stand and fight to a degree with other platforms that you cannot with a submarine. And so one of the big takeaways from that is a submarine pretty much has to evade if it's attacked, even if that attack is not likely to be successful, and if it realizes it's been counter-detected, it loses its one big advantage, which is its stealth, and probably has to leave the area, and you've broken the initiative. So the initiative of the submarine is relatively easy to break by virtue of these three fundamental limitations. And those continue today, and that's why one of the reasons why we thought the historical analysis would bear fruit when looking forward into the future. And you think about that, the relative disadvantage of the submarine versus the things it might be trying to attack or that might be trying to attack it. This plots out the displacement of surface ships over time and the speed disadvantage of submarines relative to surface ships over time. And these are merchant ships. So if you look at how fast a submarine can go and remain stealthy over the years from 1940 World War II time frame to today, They can go about the same speed as the surface ships, about half of the speed the surface ships are that they are trying to track or hunt or destroy, which means they always have this speeded disadvantage, which means they always need to get pre-positioned in order to be able to attack a surface ship, a merchant ship, or even a warship. They can't chase it down, because to chase it down, they have to be going so fast that they're going to be detectable, and they lose their one big advantage, which is their stealth. And it also makes it hard to hear if you're driving really fast. The other thing that's happened is as submarines have developed anti-ship cruise missile technology, you would think, they don't need to get that close. They could take advantage of the speed of the cruise missile to overcome their own speed disadvantage. Well, cruise missiles have a limited warhead size, a limited payload, and while they might be very effective against a warship that is very sophisticated, systems that are vulnerable to attack, and the warships are relatively small, your average merchant ship has been growing in size dramatically over the last 50 years. And now, if you look at the average or the mean transoceanic merchant ship, it's about 200,000 tons. And so an anti-ship cruise missile against that kind of ship isn't going to do a lot of damage. And you might get a mission kill, if you will, by hitting something valuable on the ship like the rudder or the bridge. You're not going to sink it, so that the material on that ship is not going to be lost by virtue of a submarine attack. Unlike in World War II, where ships would be sunk, the material would be lost, and that's war material that's no longer being provided to the effort. So these fundamentals of the submarine competition remain in place today, which means a lot of this historical analysis still applies going into the future. So we looked at one of the big case studies we did for the anti-submarine warfare case was World War II and the Battle of the Atlantic, because it's the most robust case, the most comprehensive case, lots of data. You've got a very long-term competition over 4 to 5 years. It moved all around the Atlantic. It wasn't just a small area. And it composed a variety of anti-submarine warfare techniques and systems. And it also involved a number of different submarine classes and different submarine operational approaches. So it gave a really robust, kind of wide-ranging set of data to use to make some insight or gain some insights about the anti-submarine warfare competition. So the one big thing to draw from this is that the slow speed of the convoys that the submarines were trying to interdict and the slow speed of the submarines themselves led to this kind of slow speed competition, which John was alluding to earlier. The patrol areas of the submarine were designed to intercept the convoy as it came across the Atlantic because the submarines couldn't chase them down, and they didn't have any weapons that were able to reach them except by the submarine getting very close to the convoy. So the patrol areas expanded over time to go where the convoys were going because the submarines had to position themselves in a place where they could go attack the convoys as they passed. And so as the war expanded, you know, as Operation Torch began in the in North Africa and provided a lot of shipping traffic through there, as America got brought into the war and was providing, you know, a lot of opportunities to attack convoys on the East Coast, the patrol areas expanded. And then they contracted late in the war as Germany lost basing that afforded them the ability to get ships out here, and then as the war effort started to focus on the European continent. So you can kind of see this sort of expansion and contraction over time in slow motion as the war transitioned from a small conflict, large conflict, back to a smaller conflict. Now, looking at the data, so this is the World War II Battle of the Atlantic at a glance. So there's a lot of information here, but what it's showing is the blue blob here is what the Allies were tracking, which was overall shipping losses. So these are hundreds of thousands of tons of shipping lost per month to the Allies, in the blue. The green, the line at the bottom, is how many submarines the Germans lost per month over the course of the Battle of the Atlantic. The orange line is the submarine presence that the Germans were able to maintain on deployment in the Atlantic in a month. And then there's a bunch of events that have occurred, that occurred during the course of the war to drive those trends one way or the other. So the Allies were tracking these overall shipping losses because they felt like, fundamentally their job is to get war material from the arsenal of democracy in the United States over to the European, over to Britain, primarily, to stand by for an invasion and then subsequently to supply the invasion in both North Africa and the European continent. A couple of interesting things about this is, so you can see the shipping losses kind of spike early on and then they grow dramatically. This happens to correlate with when the US entered the war and there are a lot of convoys that were suddenly targets of opportunity for the Germans that they'd been holding off on attacking because they didn't want to bring the U.S. into the war earlier than necessary. So this spike is largely due to the U.S. entering the war and giving a lot of juicy targets on the U.S. East Coast. But out here in the late 1942, the Allies were able to match their shipping losses with ship construction. So from that point on, they were producing more ships than they ever lost in any month of the war. Another interesting thing is the amount of Allied shipping that they entered the war with was about 40 million tons. And they're in any given month losing, they had a spike at 700,000 there, but in any given month you're looking at between 3 to 5 at the most, 500,000 tons. So they could have gone many more years without producing any shipping and losing this many ships and still not have gotten into a crisis in terms of their ability to supply the European continent. So what was interesting is the Allies were tracking this overall shipping losses, like that was the thing that was gonna keep them in the war, when in reality they had lots of shipping. They had a surplus of shipping and they were producing more shipping every month as the war went on and keeping up with the German losses or the losses from the Germans. What they really should have been tracking is the losses in specific areas, because what would happen is, in this time, until late in the war, the Germans weren't able to sink any troop transports or any oilers. They weren't really going after specific types of ships, they were just sinking whatever. So they were sinking a lot of the beans and toilet paper and other supplies, and not sinking the things that really are going to make the most difference for the war effort, which would be soldiers, sailors, fuel, petroleum products, that kind of thing. So in reality, maybe that wasn't the best metric. So the Allies weren't getting a good sense of how the war effort was going to progress. They were just getting this aggregate picture and making decisions based on that. They also had a metric of sinking U-boats. They felt like, well, if I sink more U-boats, then that's going to make my shipping safer as it goes across the Atlantic. And you can see on here, the other big finding we had was U-boat sinkings didn't really ever rise very high. They had a spike in this middle of 1943, which was due to a number of units being able to come together and just the contact that resulted from a lot of convoys going through and a lot of activity, and then it dropped back down. And you can see from the presence, the Germans never really had a problem maintaining U-boat presence in the Atlantic. It ramped up as they built more U-boats and got more basing opportunities in France. steadily, you know, until here, and then even late in the war, they were still maintaining 50 or more submarines in the Atlantic, which is, you know, five times the number they had at the beginning of the war. So the U-boat losses were not really significant at any point in the war, yet the Allies were able to drive down shipping losses several times, and then even after the U.S. entered the war and got schwacked pretty hard, they were able to still drive down shipping losses, and they remained low for the rest of the war, even though there was significant U-boat presence out there. So the sinking of U-boats, which is an Allied metric, wasn't really a good one to drive a result of reducing shipping losses. Somehow shipping losses were being reduced independent of sinking U-boats. If you look at from the German, or so to look a little more deeply at this one little blip here, even that blip shows kind of this point that somehow sinking U-boats wasn't what was necessary. This is a zoom in on the period from 40 to 44, but looking specifically at when the U.S. entered the war. So the same information is on the previous chart, except, you know, the blue here is showing the overall shipping losses. The purple shows the amount of shipping losses that came on the U.S. East Coast. So you can see as the U.S. entered the war, almost all of the shipping losses the Allies were sustaining were off the U.S. East Coast. And that was because the U.S. entered the war, there were a lot of coastal convoys going up and down the East Coast to keep the big convoys that were going to Europe supplied. And those were fat targets for the Germans, who were just waiting for the U.S. to enter the war. There were already submarines over there, submarines that the Germans had sent to gain intelligence, just waiting for the U.S. to enter the war because these ships were unescorted and not operating convoys. And so people off the U.S. East Coast were seeing ships get attacked in detail by German U-boats as soon as the U.S. entered the war. So by January 1942, you see this huge spike as the Germans took advantage of that opportunity. But then those shipping losses were driven down rapidly, even though losses off the U.S. East Coast, which is this green line, didn't ever go up. So U-boat losses remained really low. So somehow the Americans were able to drive down those losses without killing any U-boats. And what happened there was all the U.S. did was start convoying, putting their coastal shipping into convoys, and putting escorts with them, even though those escorts in most cases were not armed and didn't have radar. So all they would do is drive around with the convoy, and if a submarine was spotted, it would go chase down the submarine and make it leave. And that was all they could do because they couldn't sink it. They couldn't really trail it for very long because they didn't have radar, because they didn't want to leave their convoy behind. So they were able to drive down these losses without killing the submarine. So clearly they're taking advantage of the inherent limitation of the submarine, because as soon as the submarine gets detected and somebody starts taking action, it's got to run away and it's lost its initiative and it's not going to catch up with the convoy again because it's too slow. So that strategy that they fell into was very effective, but their metric remained killing U-boats, not whether the shipping was necessarily getting through independent of that. Being able to separate those two would have been very useful. Now, late in the war, they realized that this was happening and started to rethink the utility of going after U-boats for the kill. But most of the war, they thought killing the U-boats was the mechanism that was resulting in the shipping losses going down. Now, from the German perspective, their metric was U-boat productivity. So Dönitz, the U-boat commander, was tracking how much shipping each U-boat sunk per month. So you can get an idea of how are his commanders doing and how is the hunting going. So you can see early in the war, the blue shows the U-boat productivity, meaning shipping losses per U-boat per month. It kind of spikes, but it's very high. So very high productivity per U-boat, because there's not very many U-boats. Again, that's orange's U-boat presence. So you've only got maybe 10 U-boats on deployment, and all of them are getting a lot of kills, a lot of sinkings, which gets a lot of productivity. And then as the U-boat presence goes up, you see a decrease in productivity, which is kind of what you expect, because more boats out there, the pickings might be slimmer for any given one of them. But we'll see in a second that that's not necessarily the case. There are a lot more pickings to be had. And so for some reason, they were not able to take advantage of the increase in U-boat presence and maintain their productivity. And again, it gets to this issue of what was causing the U-boats to not be effective anymore after this time frame. Well, and it had a lot to do with the fact that the Allies at this point had some escorts with radars and spotlights and things that would be able to foil potential U-boat attacks. No U-boats were getting really killed because your U-boat losses are still in the single digits. But the U-boats were going out there getting dissuaded, getting disrupted, and losing their opportunities to attack.
their productivity drops. So even though they're driving more U-boats out into the water, they're getting fewer and fewer losses per U-boat. And to kind of show, you know, what the pickings were. So those more U-boats, as they sent more U-boats out, they should not have had a drop in productivity, because the percentage of ships sunk in those convoys were down in the single digits. So in any given convoy, even in the worst months, even the worst performing convoys, there was less than 5% ships lost in each convoy, which means U-boats should have had a lot more ships to attack. You know, the wolf packs, as they grew in size, should have been able to get more kills and retain the same productivity per U-boat, but they weren't. And that was because the Allies at this point were mounting, you know, more effective convoy escort operations, but still not killing any U-boats. And at that point, they didn't really have, they had some depth charges and not very effective weapons. So it was not surprising they weren't killing a lot of U-boats, but the Allies were beating themselves up thinking they weren't being effective, but in reality they were. And what you can see, the effectiveness of just convoying alone is sort of displayed very well by the Japanese experience in World War II. So in Japan, they did not have enough ships to really convoy, because it does cost about 10 to 20% more ships to do convoys, just because they got to, you know, form them all up, and then they got to wait, and once everybody's there, you're just like traveling with any group, so you got to herd the cats, get the cats together, go, and then you got to wait while everybody gets out of the bus. So the convoy does tend to be less efficient. So the Japanese didn't have enough ships to do that. They also didn't have enough escorts to spare to go off and escort convoys around. And they also thought that they were inside their, you know, anti-excess ring inside the Japanese Empire. So they thought, well, you know, my guys should be relatively safe. So they traveled almost exclusively in single or two-ship deployments. So you can see the number of convoys the Japanese did. They did about 1,200 single-ship transits. And they only did, well, you know, single digits, down in less than 10 convoys of 13 or more ships, compared to what the Allies were doing, which is they were doing convoys of 60 to 80 ships on average by the middle of the war. And you can see the losses, though, if you go to these convoys, the losses in the larger convoys were down for the Japanese less than 10%, you know, 5 to 10%. So, you know, getting close to the numbers that the Allies were experiencing. But these single ship convoys, if you will, ships traveling independently, their losses were up near 25% for the Japanese. And you know, that gets to the fact that just the convoy operation alone, you know, reduces the area, you know, that the submarine's able to find a target in. It makes it so that you gotta find the convoy, as opposed to just waiting for a ship to wander along in a very large area. And then once you get there, there's escorts with that, because you can't escort each individual ship, but you can escort a convoy. And so when you arrive and try to attack the convoy, you may find yourself being beset upon by an escort that then breaks up your attack, and then you're forced to retreat. But just convoying alone was beneficial. The other thing that they found is that if you really want to kill a submarine, you can't do it with a single escort. Like a single escort track running down a submarine is not likely to be effective. And the reason for that is the guy who's trying to track the submarine, if he's going to turn around and then try to shoot the submarine, he's going to lose contact with the submarine when he's attacking it, because you're going to run over the top of it while you're sending out depth charges. Then, of course, you can't hear anything because the depth charges are going off. You don't have very good sonar at that time. So what you needed was somebody to track the submarine and somebody to attack the submarine. And so the guy that's attacking the submarine can't hear anything, but the guy that's tracking the submarine can continue to do so. And you can see the percentage of kills for the coordinated attacks is much higher than that of single ship attacks. So you can see single ship chance of regaining contact after the initial engagement much higher with the coordinated, where you get multiple platforms looking for it. And then up here you can see the percent successful is 55% for the coordinated, you know, multi-ship, multi-platform attack versus 17% for the 5% for the independent, 12% for the independent. And then the last part of the kill chain is a weapon. And so the other thing they found is that the depth charges weren't a very effective weapon, because again, I'm running over the submarine, I lose contact with where it is, I'm dumping depth charges out the back and hoping that one of them will get close enough to damage the submarine. So even though the depth charge has a much larger lethal radius than the other weapons they had available to them, they found that the percentage of kills is much lower than with the squid, which is a forward firing weapon, which is kind of a mortar
rocket-propelled mortar, similar to what a lot of countries still use today, like the Hedgehog. And the Hedgehog and the Squid allowed the ship to track the submarine, launch a weapon at it that it could aim to some degree, and get down on the submarine target, get close enough to be able to get a kill. So even though the lethal radius was essentially zero, meaning it had to actually hit the submarine and go off with a contact fuse, they were still getting much higher percentages of kills because they could at least aim it, and they could put a barrage down of a number of them, so you got a little bit of an area coverage. So what's interesting is that it's the size of the warhead is not nearly as important as the precision with which you're able to deliver it, which gets to this idea of the battle network and the kill chain. Is if you are going to try to kill a submarine, you got to have the whole kill chain, which means you got to have something that's able to consummate the engagement. So an example of so how offensive ASW when you're trying to kill a submarine, how that worked for the Allies was the Bay of Biscay. So during the middle of the war, the Germans were basing their U-boats in France because that's much closer to the deployment areas, patrol areas, so much more rapid transits. They were able to keep U-boat presence up much higher as a result of these bases in France. So to foil that, the Allies said, well, we know we have to transit through the Bay of Biscay, which is the area of water that's between France and Britain and Spain. So we'll go and start doing patrols here. This blue area was patrolled by aircraft and ships by the British initially, and then the British and the Americans later on. They were aggressively, over the course of about a year and a half, or actually almost 2 years, searching this area for submarines. The intent was, we'll kill a bunch of submarines on their way out or their way back, and then overall we'll attrite the U-boat force. So this is the data from that operation. And you can see here the red is U-boat losses per month. So you can see how kind of that spikes out there, but it stays pretty low for most of it. The purple is the percentage of U-boats stuck in the Bay of Biscay going in or out, trying to get to patrol areas or trying to get back. And the blue is the presence of U-boats out in the Atlantic, which is the same curve we saw earlier. So that's the number of overall U-boats that are able to stay deployed out in the Atlantic. These little bars in the background are the length of time in hours it takes to transit the Bay of Biscay. So 40 hours, 72, 3 days or so, and then out there it's almost a week when you get out to about 130, 140 hours. So what this is showing is, if you think about the goal of the Allies was to kill a bunch of submarines. Well, they didn't really kill any submarines till even, so they're, 6 months in, they start killing submarines. And that was only after they completed the kill chain. They had to get the weapon, they had to get the coordinated, action. They couldn't just have single ships running down submarines. So once you get coordination between a couple of ships or a ship and an airplane, and then you've got the kill chain, meaning a good weapon and something to target it, then you start seeing a couple of kills, but not very many. So you're one or two, and then one or two. So you're not really killing very many submarines. But what's happening is the number of U-boats stuck in the bay is oscillating based on the success that the Allies are having. So here early on, the U-boat stuck in the bay is 20% or so. And then it dips down here because the U-boats start transiting faster, not realizing that they're being tracked by the Allies, until they deploy a radar search receiver, which happens right here. And they realize, oh, these guys are tracked. That's why they're killing us, because they're seeing us on radar. So if you got people getting tickets at a speed trap, they don't know that they're getting tracked until they get picked up, and they still don't know how they got picked up. Well, if you get guys with radar warning receivers, they say, oh, there's a speed trap here, I'm detecting that. They start slowing down. Same thing happens here. U-boats start to slow down, start to submerge, start to divert or evade, and you get longer or more ships stuck in the bay. And over time, that plays out as radars and radar countermeasures, radar warning receivers come in, and you get this back and forth a little bit. But over time, what you see is the Allies continue to increase the number of submarines stuck in the bay because they're being harassed by the Allied forces. But they still don't lose very many submarines. So even here, the 1 month they had like a spike here, July 1943, they lost 12 submarines in a month, which is a very small fraction of the overall number of submarines deployed. But still, it's a it's a decent spike. But that was the only month there was a significant loss of submarines. What was really happening, though, was the number of submarines that was able to stay on deployment was going down because the percentage that were stuck in the bay was going up this entire time. And so what the Allies did essentially is impose a virtual attrition on the Germans by slowing down the submarines, forcing them to take a more circuitous path,
as the war progressed. So as the operation progressed, the transit lanes that they were using went from this very straight one in, you know, the early part, so through mid-1943, changed in April from 1943 to be almost all going back down to the coast of Spain and around, which dramatically increased the time it took to get out of the bay. So because the Allies were harassing the submarines, they were reducing the submarine presence out in the Atlantic, slowing down submarine operations. And they killed a few here in a couple of months, but the number of submarines killed would really have a very insignificant impact on the overall number of submarines deployed.
You get spikes there in the longer days too.
Right. Good point. In the summer you get a little bit some spikes where that you would otherwise wouldn't have. But if you get like a spike of 12 there, and your overall number of submarines deployed is maybe in the hundreds, so you've got more than 100 here, and you get the spike, so you do get a little bit of a drop down there. But again, the losses are not enough to really attrite the U-boat fleet very much. What you're seeing mostly is this slowing down of the U-boat deployment pattern. Mm-hmm. And then, so a key thing we just talked about in here was this kind of radar countermeasure competition. Because in the World War II, sonar wasn't really a useful technique for doing submarine detection. It was sometimes used in tracking when you got really close to a guy you knew was a submarine. But for the most part, this was done with radar, visual, and then SIGINT, meaning signals intelligence. So the competition in the ASW submarine competition in World War II was in the EM spectrum, which is surprising to people because I think it's mostly acoustic. Today it's acoustic, but then it was just in the EM spectrum. So it started out with encryption, decryption. We're all familiar with the Enigma codes and how they were broken. So the Enigma code was broken, and then again the upgraded Enigma code was broken as well. But what this shows is the lifetime of each electromagnetic spectrum advancement in the war, and how the lifetime of that advancement before the next countermeasure came along shrank over time and got shorter and shorter as the war progressed. So early on, the convoy orders that the Allies were using were decrypted by the Germans, and then the Allies didn't come up with another encryption technique for several months, hours, or almost a couple of years after that. So that decryption operation that the Germans did lasted for 30 months before it was fixed with a new encryption code from the Allies. The Allies' L-band ASW radar that they deployed on aircraft lived for almost 2 years before the Germans came up with an L-band radar receiver that was able to detect the radar. And then you could see the Enigma code was broken, and then that broken code lasted for about 10 months before a new Enigma code came along, and then the new Enigma code lasted for about 10 months before it also was broken. And then later in the war, you could see the S-band radar was then superseded by an X-band radar and the receivers for those. So these advancements get shorter and shorter in terms of their lifetime as the war progresses, because each side's working the engineering competition between the two. And you'll see a similar thing play out in John's part of the brief as well for air. But that was a big finding that we had, is that these competitions tend to speed up once you get towards the end, and it was getting ready to jump to a new band. And so for the World War II competition here, that new band was going to be acoustic sonar-based ASW. So what you see is, as we go into the Cold War, we're still detecting diesel submarines in the Arab-Israeli War of 1967 using sonar, or rather, not sonar, but radar, SIGINT, and visual primarily. So EM spectrum means are still what we used in the Cold War to detect diesel submarines. But at the end of the war, in World War II, the Germans had developed submarines that were going to be able to remain underwater for a longer period, reduce their vulnerability to EM spectrum detection, and those submarines then were going to be the new generation. Well, eventually that resulted in submarines that were less susceptible to EM detection. Then when nuclear submarines came along, nuclear submarines completely took the submarine out of the EM spectrum and enabled it to stay undersea for indefinite periods, which means your EM spectrum techniques were going to be useless in detecting them. Well, the U.S., in pursuing alternatives that they were designing for these new diesel submarines, stumbled upon passive sonar, and passive sonar as a technique to use against nuclear submarines. Nuclear submarines, because they generate noise continuously, from their propulsion machinery are vulnerable then to passive detection because they're always generating noise that could be picked up by a good passive sonar system. And so you see, when you go into the Cold War during the Iberian-Israeli War, we're already transitioning now to nuclear submarines being detected almost entirely by passive sonar, whether it's narrow band, meaning a specific frequency, or broad band, meaning just noise in the water. And then you get a small percentage of visual and radar detection, almost no radar detections, but a small percentage of visual detections that still occur as a result of a submarine being surfaced for something. And then the other E is electronics intelligence, so that's generally picking up a submarine's radio communications somewhere, like on a satellite or some other signals intelligence gathering machine. But you see now the transition here between World War II, we were getting ready to move into an acoustic competition, the war ended, and then the Cold War, we move into this acoustic competition. So the U.S. had an advantage in this acoustic competition because it kind of developed passive sonar techniques first and the sonar processing necessary for that. So we built SOSIS, which is the sound surveillance network, which we've all heard of, and installed that in places around the world so that we can monitor choke points, areas of interest, homeland, coastline, to look for Russian nuclear submarines and maybe diesel submarines, but predominantly nuclear submarines. As SOSIS improved and the processing improved, the coverage of SOSIS improved. So 1958, when SOSIS was first installed, we had some coverage like that, and then that coverage expanded as the sensor network was expanded itself physically, but also the processing was improved and enabled it to get longer detection ranges against Soviet nuclear submarines. Same phenomenon is going over in Europe. What this did was it resulted in a CONOP that the U.S. was going to pursue where they would track pretty much every Russian nuclear submarine that deployed through almost its entire deployment, by using SOSIS to find it initially, and then sending P-3 Orion ASW aircraft to then go track it for a while on their own using passive sonar, and then turn that over to U.S. nuclear attack submarines that would then remain in trail or at least some kind of rough tracking condition with the Russian or the Soviet nuclear submarine for the remainder of its deployment. So we were going to track all these submarines during their deployment, and then if war were to come, we would initiate attacks and degrade the Russian nuclear submarine or Soviet nuclear submarine fleet. So that was the CONOP that the U.S. was doing because they had this enormous passive sonar advantage. Same thing in the Pacific. These are the SOSIS coverage areas. This is all recently declassified, but if you go past 1978, the coverage is not declassified anymore. But what this shows is, out in the Pacific, we were starting to see a new trend, which was in the late 70s, the Soviets learned about sound silencing that the U.S. had been doing as a result of its own knowledge of passive sonar. Soviets learned about that through the Walker spy ring, and they got some machining gear from Toshiba and some other companies and figured out how to do some of the sound silencing techniques that the U.S. had been doing for a couple of decades previous to that. So late 70s, Soviet nuclear submarines start to get quiet, and so the coverage area of SOSIS begins to shrink. So in 1970, almost the entire Pacific was covered by SOSIS, between the number of arrays and just the processing and the loudness of the Soviet nuclear submarines. As the Soviet nuclear submarines got quieter, the coverage area shrank, and you could see that started to create a problem for the U.S. If they had this CONOP where they were going to track Soviet nuclear submarines for the duration of their deployment, they were going to have gaps where their coverage didn't exist, and we'd have to either have our submarines stay in close trail on them all the time, without the benefit of any SOSIS backup, or even the P-8s were going to have or P-3s were going to have difficulty tracking them on passive sonar as well. Or we'd have to come up with a different CONOP. And so what the U.S. did over time is come up with a CONOP where instead of relying on this continuous track, they were going to go threaten the Russian nuclear ballistic missile submarine fleet and its bastions using U.S. attack submarines. That would force the Soviets to bring their best attack submarines back into those bastions to protect their SSBNs and reduce the number of frontline Soviet attack submarines that were deployed overseas, meaning in places that we wanted to operate. And that ended up being the CONOP that the U.S. pursued late in the Cold War. And that tried to impose, if you will, a bit of virtual attrition on the Soviets by forcing them to take their best submarines, keep them at home, as opposed to deploying them overseas where we might get they might be a threat to us.
What are the little islands in there?
So these are just, this is us
spots of SOSIS coverage that existed. So it means there's some kind of SOSIS array was in these areas. So this, that's Guamish. I'm not sure what exactly that is, and I'm not sure what island that is. But there were SOSIS arrays or sensors in various places around the world that enabled that coverage to be tied together, and that's how you got this coverage across the entire Pacific. And then as the Soviet submarines got quieter, they couldn't see, they couldn't hear as far away, so the coverage now shrinks down to the area around the sensor, as opposed to being as much broader area.
So was the Seawolf class kind of the outcome of the Bastion Doctrine?
Yes. Right? So the idea was that
we need something like this.
Right. So the Seawolf was that the idea that we would build very large attack submarines with lots of weapons that were very quiet, and then we could use those to go into the bastions and wreak havoc with the Soviet submarine fleet because they could remain deployed for a long time because they wouldn't run out of weapons as quickly. And that would drive the Soviets to have to keep their best submarines at home. And that would reduce the number that we would have to encounter out in the fleet. We might be dealing with a less sophisticated group of submarines out in the fleet. What this showed was that just like in World War II, we were reaching a point though where this competition was likely to culminate. This passive sonar competition was going to, reach the point with this move counter move effort to where someone's going to have to jump to a new way of doing ASW because submarines were going to continue to get quieter, passive sonar was going to get harder and harder to use as a detection technique, and we'd have to come up with a different way of finding submarines, or else we would be forced to continue to come up with creative con ops that dealt with the lack of a complete coverage over areas where the Soviets were likely to deploy. So it was just like World War II, where the Germans were getting ready to deploy submarines that were going to take them out of the EM spectrum. The Russians were going to be deploying submarines that would take them out of the passive sonar competition. We'd have to come up with a different way to find submarines.
But we were saved by the bell.
Saved by the bell, exactly. Yeah. So Owen Cote up at MIT had that great formulation of saved by the bell, because in both cases, he applied to the Cold War's case, but you could also apply it to the World War II case just as easily and look at how these competitions were going to reach a culminating point, and in both wars, if you will, we got out of it because the one competitor failed for other reasons. So at the end of World War II, we would have had this big challenge of German submarines that were able to not be detected by radar or signals intelligence, and we would have had to come up with better sonars than we had at that time, which were very unsophisticated. Then that competition transitioned from the EM spectrum to passive sonar. Our passive sonar performance went down as the Soviets deployed a lot of submarines initially. And then we kind of figured out that passive sonar was as good as it was, focused on our own sound silencing, got a huge advantage in the passive sonar competition because our submarines were so much quieter than the Soviet submarines until they realized that's what was happening, began to quiet their own submarines because you can just choose to do that. And then right around the in the time when that was starting to become a big problem, we were saved by the bell. And so what this chart shows is qualitative U.S. ASW capability over time. And so you can see it improves through here, it goes down through here, improves again, and then goes down again. We found at the end of the Cold War that we were in a situation we were going to have to come up with a new way to do ASW. So some new technologies that were being pursued were mostly active sonar, so variable depth sonars, low-frequency active acoustic sonars, multi-static active sonar. So active sonar was the direction that we were likely to go had that competition continued. It got put in stasis, essentially, because the Soviet threat went away, those submarines got put up on blocks, and the rest of the world's submarines were noisier. Even the nuclear ones were back, noisier ones that fit more in this kind of era rather than later in the era.
What is ROW?
Rest of world. So where is this competition going next? It's going to shift away from techniques that rely on detecting noise coming from the submarine, because you can always choose to make your submarine quieter, and it's just a matter of how much money you want to invest in that. There's the engineering challenges, especially at this day and age, are not insurmountable. So it's a matter of how much effort do you want to put into quieting your submarine. So you've given the enemy a vote, essentially, if you're going to rely on passive sonar as your detection technique.
Obviously, there's a lot of things we can do to improve our algorithms and our sensing technology and continue to extract more and more noise from the ocean to try to make it so that we can retain some detection range on passive sonar. But fundamentally, you've handed the enemy the ability to make himself less detectable. So it's likely the competition is going to shift toward another detection technique. So active sonar-based techniques with low-frequency active probably being a predominant player. Non-acoustic phenomena, which have been investigated for a long time, but which could leverage big data in a way that previous applications of those techniques couldn't use. So you can do massive parallel processing to look at, you know, wakes or chemicals or radiation in the water and, you know, find things that previously would have been very hard to find with the level of processing available in the Cold War when we were previously pursuing those. And then background noise, you're looking for changes in ambient noise in the ocean. So processing and modeling are going to help these, probably help these transitions. But effective competitors are still going to have to think about exploiting the fundamentals of the submarine. So how can I impose virtual attrition on a submarine fleet by taking advantage of the fact that the submarines are relatively slow, don't have great situational awareness, and are not really able to defend themselves very well. So if you want to, you know, be effective in this competition, you got to look at ways to take advantage of those three things. And so we, as the U.S., should think about our potential adversaries trying to take advantage of those fundamentals with us. And how can we change those fundamentals? You know, so if we can make our submarines better able to defend themselves, that might be a way to stand and fight instead of having to respond to every attack, even if it's very unlikely to result in a hit. Those are kinds of things that we would look at doing. So that's the submarine case, and so I'll turn it over to John now to talk about the air attack versus air defense.
One question.
Yes.
With regard to the China's submarine force growing,
right?
If you're allowed to say anything about this, do you see like the Cold War redux and the U.S. using the same things we did against the Soviets with regard to the Chinese force?
So probably not as much. So the Soviet case, we leveraged the kind of the Soviet way of operating. So you can certainly leverage geography, which is something we try to do against the Soviets. So you can look at ways to leverage geography to, you know, identify choke points, areas that, you know, Chinese submarines would have to go through to reach, you know, an area that's of interest to them. So you could use those choke points and make, you know, detection systems or platforms in those areas, which is what we did against the Soviets. You could also look at, you know, maybe going after the strategy of the enemy. So that's what we did with the Soviets, is their strategy was very dependent on having a survivable second strike capability with their SSBN force. So by threatening that, it was neuralgic for the Soviets, and they had to do something to protect that second strike capability. So they responded, you know, pretty robustly to the potential threat of U.S. attack submarines in their bastions. I don't know if the Chinese would necessarily react the same way, but they might. It seems like, yeah. It depends on what degree the adversary values that second strike capability, whether you could use that sort of strategy. But yeah, those seem to be the two main areas that you might be able to run parallels between the Soviet case and the Chinese case.
So one thing I should have mentioned earlier, and I made a note to myself to stick a chart into this effect, is I probably should have defined what a battle network is before we kicked off. So the idea is that because you have the ability, starting about 100 years ago, to begin to separate sort of your broad area sensors, your weapons, your command and control, and your localization sensors from each other. That allows each one of those pieces to potentially be more effective. So a early example of this would be indirect artillery fire, where you have a forward observer who's linked to a fire control center that then assigns guns to shoot at the thing the observer can see but the guns can't. So now you have the ability for the commanders to more efficiently use their resources. Got this observer with a pair of binoculars that can now call on massive firepower to kill things he couldn't kill himself. And the guns obviously can hit things that they can't physically target because they can't see them, they may not have line of sight, things like that. So you get lots of advantages out of, you know, sort of taking your weapon system, hitting it with a hammer, and putting the pieces in different areas. As long as you can link them somehow, with some form of electronic communications. So having said all that, we'll talk about sort of the fundamentals of aircraft. And again, just as with the submarines, one of the reasons that looking at historical examples matters is that there's some fundamental attributes of airplanes that really haven't changed over the last 100 years. They've, you know, become better at some of these things, but they've always been there. One is relative speed. So air operations unfold quickly, and aircraft can be at, you know, one place in the morning and a completely different place, maybe hundreds or you know, many hundreds of miles away in the afternoon, and then at a third place at night, that sort of thing. And that kind of blends into access. The sea services are fond of pointing out that about 70% of the Earth's surface is covered with water. It's often less remarked that 100% of the Earth's surface is covered with air. So at least in theory, you could put an airplane anywhere in the world as long as you can survive and you have enough range to get there. There are three things that are sort of less advantageous to airplanes. One of them is their inherent fragility. Flying is hard, and airplanes tend to be relatively easy to damage, particularly when compared to things like ships or armored fighting vehicles, things like that. Second is relatively low payload, and again, compared to things like ships or even ground vehicles, putting, you know, tens of thousands of pounds of payload onto an airplane, can it be done? Yes, but it's really expensive and difficult. And compared to things like a ship, again, where you could have, you know, many thousands of tons of payload, you can't build an airplane that big to carry that much stuff. And then you have relatively low combat persistence, which means once you get out there, because you have a low payload and limited amounts of fuel and range, you're not going to be wherever you go for very long. And as a result, the combination of these last two factors means that if you're up against a large target set protected by capable, competent forces, you're going to have to make a lot of trips. And that drives you to very large sortie counts. And you can see in the lower left-hand corner, you're talking generally tens of thousands of sorties per month in order to run an effective air campaign. What that results in is very high sensitivity on the part of air forces to actual attrition, or getting airplanes shot down. And we'll talk about that a little bit. We might as well talk about it now. So if you look at a 4% attrition rate, doesn't sound too bad. You've got 96% chance of coming back from any given mission. But over the course of 30 missions, which was a standard bomber command tour during World War II, and later on, the Army Air Corps started out at 25 and later went to 30 for the 8th Air Force. If you're looking at a 4% permission attrition rate, your chances of surviving your tour are about 30%. So that tends to do real damage to aircrew morale, because they can run these stats just like anybody else can. Not only that, you also lose 70% of your airplanes over the course of over the course of using them 30 times. And if you're trying to fly your airplanes multiple times per day, this can happen really fast with modern air forces. You can really lose a lot of airplanes in a hurry, even with relatively small per sortie attrition. Before I get to the upper right hand area, I'll talk a little bit about what daylight precision bombing looked like in the 30s and 40s. By the start of World War II, the big air forces that were involved in the European conflict, the RAF, the U.S. Army Air Corps, and the Germans had all developed some pretty sophisticated analog computing bomb sites. The most well-known, at least for us American-type folks, is the Norden bomb site. It's a picture of it here. It was classified top secret and all those sorts of things, unbeknownst to the Army Air Corps. An employee of the Norden company had actually sold the designs to the Germans in 1937, and they had improved upon them and built this, the Loftus 7 bomb site, which had comparable capability to the Norden. And what that resulted in, if you look at the data from actual Army Air Corps daylight bombing missions in 1943 in combat, they were able to achieve about a 1,200-foot CEP, And if you look at an industrial facility of the time period, it's about the same size as the U.S. Capitol building. A little hard to see, but that's what that is. And you had 100 airplanes drop their bomb loads on it with a 1,200-foot CEP. You can see that you're going to get a number of hits with several thousands of pounds of bombs per dot there. And you're going to do significant damage to that facility. So that means that if you could fly in daylight and use your analog computing bomb sites so the weather's good and all that sort of thing, it was actually possible to hit industrial targets fairly effectively if you could do that. The problem came from the fact that the enemy gets a vote. And in many cases, losses were not only well above 4% in a lot of the daylight raids, they resulted in kind of a weird statistical factoid. So if you look at this part up here, what you see is the three big air forces, kind of their experience of the first 12 months of operations in the European theater. So for the Luftwaffe and the RAF, early in the war, you're looking at kind of September 39 to September 40, and for the 8th Air Force, you're looking at July 43 through June 44, is really kind of when the operations got into serious numbers of sorties and things like that. You can see that there were a number of months in there where they were trying to operate in daylight against full-up, effective adversary defenses where instead of being down here, they were here or above. So what's a little shaded area? The shaded area is that for every, it compares the empty weight of the bombers you're using, or losing in this case, to the weight of bombs you drop inside this 1,000-foot circle that the Army Air Corps defined as the target area. So in many cases, what you wound up doing was dropping a larger amount of airframe empty weight on the enemy territory than you were dropping bombs accurately near their factories and things like that. And that's probably not a good way to win an air war when you're actually exporting more airframe empty weight than you're dropping accurate bombs. So in addition to the issues that you have with crew morale and just trying to keep your force strength up, you're not being particularly effective at taking things out in kind of an industrial way. So what did people do? This is, again, sort of the RAF night bomber offensive at a glance. There's a lot of stuff here to take a look at, and I won't take you through all of it because I'll talk about some of these things as we go forward, but the main things to look at here are initially the RAF in late 1939 attempted some daylight bombing operations against the Germans, and what they found was that it was extremely expensive. The attacks were fairly accurate when they were made, but they lost a lot of airplanes. So in around December of 1939, they decided that primarily they would operate their bombers at night. And that solved the survivability problem. As you can see, the probability that a crew survived a 30 mission tour, which is the green line here, goes from very low when they're trying to do daylight operations in late 39 to very high when they switch to night operations. So that solved the bomber crew survivability problem initially, but at the same time, their ability to actually hit anything also dropped off. So they were able to their bomber crews were able to survive, but they weren't being very effective in terms of dropping weapons anywhere near the targets that they were trying to hit. So that's sort of the red line here. And then finally, the other thing to note is sort of the cumulative weight of sorties that they were able to fly against the Germans. And you can see that really early on in the war, there wasn't a whole lot happening there, even though the RAF had been trained and designed to do bombing, ostensibly at night. So there were a number of things that they had not done in order to enable that capability. And one of them was create navigational aids and bombing aids for their crews. They were relying on dead reckoning supplemented by celestial navigation fixes on stars and the moon and things like that. And what that resulted in was before about, the end of 1941, if you took a look at where the bombs were landing, the way that the British operated was they target for tonight is Bremen. So all the crews would then go and plot their own route to Bremen, and they would determine their own takeoff time. The only rules were they had to be, you know, outside of German airspace before it got light. So over a period of 8 to 12 to maybe 14 hours, you would have a number of airplanes flying a number of different courses to get to Bremen. And one of the things that happened here was, as air crew are prone to do, they, you know, many of them would say, no, this is my secret route. You know, so everybody was flying a different course. The other thing to note was that, for the most part, they weren't actually finding the things that they were supposed to hit. So given the accuracy that was highlighted in a study that was ordered by Prime Minister Churchill in September of 1941 to go back and look at strike photos and things like that, what they found was that only about 10% of the crews were dropping their weapons within five statute miles of the target city. If you take that and use that as the CEP, and then you plot 100 dots, what you get is, again, if you're trying to hit the Capitol building in DC, you get bombs scattered from Manassas to Baltimore. And in many cases, the Germans had a hard time figuring out what the target of the raids was. And you can see why. It wasn't until, you know, well into 1941 that the Germans began to seriously think about night defenses, because as the report, which was written by a gentleman whose last name was Butt, the Butt Report, pointed out, really the bomber command operation kind of consisted of exporting bombs to various places in Germany. A lot of them were just landing in open countryside kind of stuff. So that is sort of the state of play of the battle network up to this point, and we'll talk about how the defenses developed. So late in 1941, after a number of raids that had actually found Berlin and things like that, it became kind of embarrassing for Goering and other high-ranking Luftwaffe officials that the British were continuing to operate bombers over the top of Germany, and they decided that they would actually institute some night defenses. So what they did was they built, they got this guy, Joseph Kammhuber, who was a general, put in charge of it, and in a very orderly Germanic fashion, decided that they would build a number of boxes to intercept the British bombers. And this was a pretty rational way to approach this, right? So you got all these bombers coming in here on more or less random looking routes over a long period of time. So I'm going to create a barrier defense with a bunch of boxes. Each box has a radio beacon in it, and a German night fighter would orbit around that beacon and be tracked by a Wurzburg target radar, or target tracking radar, originally developed to be able to guide anti-aircraft gunfire. So one radar is tracking the fighter. Another one of these radars, cued by an early warning radar, was used to track the bomber, and they actually developed a little system where, believe it or not, they had kind of a frosted glass table, one guy talking to one Wurzburg operator, one guy talking to another, and they would shine little flashlights up there, and it was the job of the controller to look at where the lights were on the table and try to get them together inside the box. So that's how they did their intercepts, and they could do about 10 of those per hour. Six per hour. So it took about 10 minutes per intercept. So what you have, and that was fine. So you had, the bombers were kind of spread out in time and space. The defenses were spread out in time and space. And they became pretty effective at shooting down RAF bombers coming in. So in early 1942, the British developed a nave called G, which is the ancestor of Loran, if you're familiar with that. Essentially, it had several transmitters in England, and if you looked at the difference in time of arrival of pulses from each one of those transmitters, you could figure out where you were based on a map that showed what the time differential would be between them. This was originally designed to be a navigational aid, but it allowed the bomber command to do a couple things. One was institute what they called the bomber stream. So they were able to, rather than just saying, okay, everybody go to Bremen at some time tonight, they would say, all right, what we're going to do is we're going to fly this particular route, so they're going to concentrate their airplanes in time, And they would also concentrate them in space by giving different units and aircraft different times to be over the target. So what that did is, rather than, you know, allowing the airplanes to kind of meander all over the defenses, you would concentrate a larger number of aircraft against a smaller portion of the defenses. And given the fact that the defenses had a limited ability to engage aircraft over time, it worked in a way kind of similar to the way convoys worked, in that, you know, even though you have the same number of aircraft coming by, you know, a particular submarine only has so many weapons it can shoot in a given period of time. Same thing with the defenses here. So that helped immensely in terms of decreasing losses for the RAF. The Germans fielded first of all, they identified the purpose of the G emissions in about 82 days from the time that they were first employed in combat. They fielded jammers about 67 days after that. And then after about 267 days operational life, which is longer than what the Brits expected, G was essentially useless over Germany. One of the disadvantages that it also had was its maximum range limited it to essentially use over western parts of Germany. And the reason for that was the aircraft actually had to have, obviously, line of sight back to the transmitters in the UK. So at some point, you get to a distance where you no longer have line of sight back to the transmitters, and G's useless anyway. So as it became less and less useful, the British had to come up with some other ways to help them navigate. One of those was what they called H2S, which was a S-band radar. And it was fielded in early 1943, first used in combat on the 30th of January 1943. And it provided navigation accuracy independent from range. So now you have kind of a self-contained electronic navigation aid on the bombers that allowed them to fly wherever they wanted to. And as long as they had a decent target, like the land-water contrast provided by the Zeider Z, which you can see in the lower left, that's an actual H2S picture of the Zeider Z. And you can tell, hey, you know, here's where it is. I can tell where I am relative to those things. You can get some decent navigational accuracy and even good bombing accuracy out of that if you have a city located on a large river or on a coastline or something like that. And you can at least, you can tell here, the built-up areas reflect more brightly than areas where that are forest and things like that, so you can at least find a city kind of stuff. So that helped as well. The Germans didn't have the cavity magnetron technology that enabled the Allies to generate high powers at S-band frequencies and above. So they could not build jammers to go against this type of system until very late in the war. This is something we'll hit on a little bit later when it comes to air operations. One of the H2S equipped airplanes was shot down on the second time they tried to use it in combat, 3 days after the first use. The Germans recovered that set, and within, you know, about 3 weeks had started a very large program to figure out how to counter this new technology. And as a result of that, within about 7-8 months, they had radar receivers on their night fighter force. They were actually able to use the transmissions of the H2S set to home in on the Pathfinder aircraft and the bomber stream. So one of the reasons that it actually took that long to counter this was the fact that this was a technology that the Germans were just completely unfamiliar with. Let's talk a little bit about the Battle of Hamburg, where a lot of these things came together. It's July 1943, and the RAF introduces what they called window, what the American Air Force now calls chaff, and at the time the Germans called their version of it duple. Now both sides had had this technology for about a year and a half and had been self-deterred from using it because they weren't sure whether it would give them an advantage. It was so easy to implement that they felt if they used it, the other guys would copy it really quickly and use it against them. And it wasn't until July of 1943 that the British felt confident enough in their ability to counter window-like technology that they finally cleared it for use against the Germans. And when they first used it, what they did was about once a minute, they would have their bomber aircraft toss a one-pound bundle of aluminized paper out of the airplane, and that took about 15 minutes to fall. And what the Germans, in their highly controlled defensive scheme, saw was not a stream of bombers, with about 700 showing up over the course of about an hour or so. Instead, they saw about 11,000 bomber-like returns on their radar scopes, and initially they couldn't distinguish the ones that were real from the ones that weren't. And this completely negated the effectiveness not only of their ground-based radars, their airborne radars operated in similar frequencies, so their airborne night fighters had trouble detecting bomber aircraft, and then it ultimately resulted in about a 75% decrease in losses during the Battle of Hamburg relative to earlier raids on the same city without using window. So over the course of about a week, there were a series of four or five raids on Hamburg that ultimately, in one of them, resulted in the first man-made firestorm and killed tens of thousands of people. And this caused a crisis at sort of the highest levels of the German government. They, you know, cast about for a way to restore the effectiveness of the night defenses, because this was a, you know, first time a German city had essentially been burned down. And it was a big deal. So the way that they approached it was kind of twofold. The first thing they did was they adopted what they call the Wildesau tactics. There was a ex-bomber pilot named Hajo Hermann, who had been pushing for quite a while to use single-seat day fighters with no radar over the top of the targets to attack the RAF bombers. And the way it would work is they would fly at relatively high altitude, 25 to 30,000 feet, look down, and then actually use the fires that the British were setting in the city to silhouette the bomber aircraft, and then dive down and kill them. So that was one approach that they immediately adopted. And the other was to completely get rid of the highly centralized Kammhuber line-like defenses. And they went to a very different way of operating their night fighters. And what they did was they had ground controllers provide kind of a general running commentary on the course and speed and expected target of the bomber stream. So the bombers are there, and they're throwing the window out. So the one thing that the Germans did know was where the bomber stream was, because they were the biggest thing on the radar target. So they could tell the night fighter pilots where the stream was, and they would tell them to go to a radio beacon in Germany that was close to where the bomber stream was, and then they would feed them into the bomber stream. And the night fighter radar operators pretty quickly realized that when they saw radar returns that were rapidly approaching the fighter itself, that was probably strips of aluminum foil that were falling, and the returns that were approaching much more slowly were actual aircraft. So they were able to, through experience, or what we would now use Doppler radar processing to do, figure out which were the real returns. And it turns out after about 3 or 4 weeks, the night defenses had adapted to window well enough that they were actually more effective than they had been prior to the raid on Hamburg because of the changes that they made. So we'll get to the end of this competition. So at this point, the British had succeeded in essentially blinding the sensors of the German night air defenses. And what they found was initially, that was successful, but within a few weeks, the Germans had been able to use sort of low-tech adaptations to get their defenses to be at least as effective and maybe more effective than they had been before. And they realized that at the heart of the new German defense scheme was this running commentary that the ground controllers were giving the Germans. So at the end of the day, not to, to drive this to extreme in terms of length, what they had to do was field communication jammers that were able to eliminate that running commentary. And they did this eventually by forming 100 group in Bomber Command, which actually at the, by late in the war had about 200 or 250 airplanes that were dedicated to electronic combat and enabling the rest of Bomber Command to do its job. Those, most of those airplanes were bombers. And in this case, the jostle VHF comm jammers that eventually cut off that commentary were 650-pound, 2.5-kilowatt jammers. They would put four of those inside a B-17 to cover the frequencies they needed to, and those airplanes would fly. The reason they picked the B-17 was it had a higher ceiling than the British bombers did, and they would use that to jam the comm and get a larger footprint for the jamming. But at the end of the day, they had to not only sort of poke out the eyes of the air defense system, they also had to cut the comm in order to get the effects that they wanted. And you can see at the point where they introduced the 100 group and the dedicated comm jamming aircraft, you get a tremendous spike in the probability of surviving a tour. And at the same time, as losses go down, you get more and more aircraft flying sorties, and that's when you really begin to do serious damage to the German war economy, starting in early 44.
Was there any problem with jamming their own communications?
That's a good question. The way that the system worked was each one of the aircraft, once they took off, they had a route. And they had a time over target, and there wasn't a whole lot of dedicated command and control of the bomber stream once it was in the air. Over the targets, the Pathfinder force, later in the war, they would have what they called a master bomber who orbited over the target and directed the folks what to do there. But those were relatively short range communications taking place in the target area, and I believe they used a different frequency range as well. So that's a good question. I'd have to go look at that in detail.
I think it would be down to the dependence on long range communication was gone.
Yeah. But you just didn't need it. The crews were highly autonomous once they were out. So you didn't need a whole lot of command
control. They also use fake transmissions as well.
Yes, yeah. So I don't think it's in here, but Alfred Price has a great book on this called Instruments of Darkness, which is well worth a read if you're interested in it at all.
One of the stories from there is the fake controller in England bursts into it has an outburst of profanity because
yes.
The pilot is disputing whether he's really the controller.
That's right.
Which the German controller says, the Englishman is now swearing, at which point the ghost says, it is not the Englishman who is swearing, it is me.
Right. So the counter to that worked for a short period of time, so there were ground-based transmitters, as Bill points out, in the UK that were used to do jamming of the and spoofing transmissions. So the Germans then switched to female controllers. The Brits then countered by getting, German-speaking, woman Air Force folks in there. So there's a back and forth here. Everybody's trying everything they can think of over the short term to make things work. And you wind up with these, confusing discussions about who's who, which didn't help the crews at all either, right? So this is just adding more confusion to what do I really do. All right, so we'll talk a little bit about Rolling Thunder and the campaign there. This is Rolling Thunder at a glance. All this stuff's in the report. And you can take a look at it there. The big things to note are at the heart of the Rolling Thunder IADS competition really was the introduction of a completely new type of air defense system, the SE-2. The way to think about that is it was a precision-guided ground-to-air weapon. So this is the first time air crew had ever faced one of those. We'll talk about the implications of that in a moment. But the background thing here is the number of SA-2 battalions present in North Vietnam over the course of Rolling Thunder, which was between 1965 and 1968. And then there's a whole bunch of back and forth in the electronic realm largely directed at how do I break the kill chain that exists inside the SA2 so that I can open up a space to operate in more effectively. Things to look at here are, first of all, you have your probability of completing a tour. Now, a tour in Rolling Thunder consisted of 100 missions, and you can see that remained compared to things like the bomber command efforts against the Germans, relatively high. Average probability of completing a tour across Rolling Thunder was a little more than 65%, as opposed to about 51% for wartime bomber command. The probability went up and down, and you get this kind of seesaw back and forth competition in the electronic realm. And one of the things that ultimately results from this is that the fraction of aircraft dedicated to supporting strike airplanes increases over time for the attacking air forces. And again, this gets to the idea of virtual attrition. If you think about this from the standpoint of the North Vietnamese Air Defense Commander, I don't know what they were really doing. They may have, as Bryan pointed out, with the Germans and the Allies, stumbled into this, but as long as they could maintain a SA-2 threat in being, their goal is not necessarily to shoot down airplanes. Their goal is to minimize the amount of things that get destroyed in North Vietnam. One way to do that is to shoot down a lot of airplanes. Another way to do that is to make the guys on the other side devote ever larger fractions of their force to suppressing the defenses. And by the end of the conflict, you were looking at, in many cases, about half the airplanes that could otherwise have been dropping bombs were actually devoted to suppressing the air defenses. And from the air defender's point of view, that's the same thing as cutting the attacking air force in half, which isn't too shabby, actually. It's not bad. Just to take a look at how this developed over time, I've got kind of a before and after picture for you. In mid-1965, when the campaign began, the North Vietnamese air defenses essentially consisted of some long-range early warning and GCI radars that could talk to MiG-17 interceptors. The U.S. countered those by flying F-4 Phantom air superiority fighters to take them out or make them less effective. And then they had some radar-directed anti-aircraft guns. That was pretty much it. The way that the U.S. countered these was by having some noise-jamming airplanes, the EB-66 destroyer-type airplanes out there, jamming them. So the preferred altitude for U.S. strike aircraft pre-SA-2 deployment really was between 15 and 25,000 feet. Why? Because that took them out of the really deadly area of anti-aircraft fire. And it was also a regime in which the relatively heavy, fast American fighters performed better than the lighter wing-loaded MiG airplanes that preferred to fly at higher altitudes. One thing to note is that, on average, heavy anti-aircraft fire in World War II and Korea required about 16,000 rounds to bring down an airplane. Once the SA-2 was initially introduced, it had a single-shot probability of kill of around 0.1. So that made it 16,000 times more effective than a single shot of a heavy anti-aircraft gun. And that gives you kind of an idea of sort of the revolutionary nature of this thing in terms of ground-based air defense. It was literally, orders of magnitude more effective than the things that had come before, and that really got the attention of the U.S. aerial forces, whether they were the Navy, Marines, or Air Force, they had to come up with some way to adapt to this. Initially, they tried to attack the SA-2 sites at low altitude, where the SA-2 wasn't very effective. You can see down here, SA-2 is not very effective down there because it had trouble with its sort of early vacuum tube technology radar of detecting targets at low altitude. The problem of going after the sites that they encountered was that in many cases they'd be surrounded by anti-aircraft defenses that resulted in very high losses for the U.S. forces, and there were a lot of decoy sites. So rather than attempting to find and kill all the SA-2s inside of North Vietnam, particularly when many of the places you thought they were actually decoy sites, The U.S. Forces quickly realized that what they needed to do was find some way to suppress these things. And over time, what ultimately happened was there was a lot of back and forth, but the U.S. Air Forces eventually had to come up with a way to kind of break a bunch of links inside the SA-2 kill chain. So they kept the EB-66s out here trying to jam the early warning radars. They put in dedicated wild weasel airplanes that were designed to attack the Van Song radars, or at least make them turn themselves off so that they didn't get hit with a anti-radiation missile. And they also introduced EC-121 airplanes to help with the MIG threat. And when you take all of that together, what you find is that by late in the conflict, a typical strike force looked something like this. So you'd have a target, you'd have probably a couple of SA-2 sites, one of which may not have actually been a real site, may have been a decoy site, and you would have Iron Hand or Wild Weasel airplanes going against those. You have some MIG-CAP escorts that are there to protect you from the MiG-17s, 19s, and 21s. You would have, way off here, EB-66 noise jammers, and then an airborne early warning airplane. And at the end of the day, just in this picture here, you got 16 airplanes, only 8 of which You have 16 strike airplanes, total of 32, only half of them are hauling bombs. All of those are fighter bombers and could have been hauling bombs. So you're at the point where really less than half the airplanes engaged in this operation are actually attacking targets. So again, we see the same trend that we talked about with respect to the ASW battle network competition. If you look at the competition from World War II, what you find is that early in the war, the useful life of electronic aids, whether they were navigation or bombing aids or radars or other defensive measures, tended to be about 80 days. By late in the war, you're down to, no kidding, 2 to 3 weeks useful life out of an electronic gizmo or a new concept of operation. The one thing that was a little bit different, and we touched on this before, is the H2S, because the Germans had such a difficult time operating in those frequencies. So in a lot of ways, that was kind of for lack of a better term, an out-of-band solution, because the guys on the other side just didn't have the technology to deal with it. One of the things to note with airborne systems is that, as we touched on again earlier, fairly quickly after they're introduced, the adversary usually winds up in physical possession of your gizmo, whatever it is. They also fairly quickly wind up in physical possession of people who know what that gizmo is and how it works. And as a result, on both sides, they're fairly quickly able to figure out, first of all, that a new system has been introduced, and second, how it works, and then how to deal with it. So the timelines here are much shorter than the timelines you saw with the submarines earlier when Brian was showing you that, and that's one of the reasons. A corollary to that is that when you introduce a new system into aerial warfare, you probably want to do it in large numbers so that you get the most operational and strategic impact out of it, rather than peanut butter spreading it into the conflict, because very quickly you're going to wind up with counters to it and its operational life is going to be fairly short anyway, so you want to get the most out of it you can, so you want to kind of distribute it throughout your fleet and then employ it in mass if you can. Rolling Thunder campaign, you see the same sort of trend. The timelines are a little bit longer. There's several reasons why that may be the case, but one of the things, well, first of all, this was, at least on the U.S. side, not the sort of existential conflict that we're talking about in World War II, so there may have been a little bit less sense of urgency. Second, the systems that we're talking about here are more complex and took longer to develop and field. But again, there are a couple things that are worth noting. One is that the SA-2, because it was this new sort of thing, kind of a self-contained battle network, took a long time to actually effectively counter. And the way it was effectively countered in the end was by breaking the communications link between the missile and the radar that was doing the guidance. At this point, computing technology was really expensive, so the big expensive computer stayed on the ground, and the missile just went where the computer told it to go. So breaking that link was the key to defeating the SA-2. And eventually that succeeded. The other thing to note is the EV-66 standoff jamming wasn't all that effective for very long, and the reason for that was that by this point, the folks on the receiving end of the jamming anticipated that was going to happen and had put in place procedures and techniques to try to counter. So, after the experience in Vietnam, and particularly the October War in 1973, the U.S. Realized that we were probably coming to one of those inflection points where really since World War II, we'd been involved in a situation where we had active radars versus active jammers that were trying to defeat them. So you had an active EW, competition going on. And in the early 1970s, the United States instigated a program to find new approaches to aircraft survivability. What ultimately emerged from that was essentially stealth technology. The big difference here was that you now had active radars in the RF spectrum that were attempting to find aircraft that were not trying to blind them with radiated energy, but instead were deflecting that energy and were attempting to hide. And that is, again, one of these shifts in the mode or the nature of the competition. And one of the things that did, if you look at it from a Soviet perspective, was certainly sometime in the mid-90s, had the Cold War continued, you would have been facing kind of the block obsolescence of a massive investment in radar-based ground air defenses on the Soviet side, had stealth technology proliferated the way it was planned to do at the end of the Cold War. So what's likely to come next? Again, just like the situation with the submarines, the competition kind of went into stasis at the end of the Cold War, but it's now kind of getting revived. So where are we likely to go? We're getting to the point where there are some systems out there that have been specifically designed to detect aircraft with reduced radar cross-sections. So you're going to have to do something else. So I would say that one of the modes you're likely to see in this competition is sort of a return to active radar countermeasures and things like that on U.S. aircraft, or utilizing that to a greater degree than has been true in the past to augment the passive signature reduction. And probably an increasing centrality of passive sensors like IR sensors and things like that going forward in both missile seekers and on the sensors that are used to localize the aircraft and things of that nature. So having said all of that, where does this put us in terms of insights from the IADS versus air attack competition? We talked about the first one of these insights, the physical access that that aircraft give the opposing forces once they're lost, and the corollary to that. We also talked about the second insight, which is you want to minimize damage to important assets if you're the IADS commander, not necessarily shoot down airplanes. This is similar to the insight that what you're really trying to do if you're the Allies in the Battle of the Atlantic is not sink submarines. You're trying to get ships and their cargoes back and forth across the Atlantic. And there may be a lot of ways to do that that don't necessarily involve sinking the entire German submarine fleet. The final insight, and this is kind of where we started, is the great sensitivity to actual attrition for air forces, excuse me, makes them extremely sensitive, or, well, their extreme sensitivity there makes them susceptible to virtual attrition. In other words, they're very willing to devote pretty sizable fractions of their efforts mitigating actual attrition. Because if they don't, they're going to wind up with no airplanes very quickly. Okay, so across the board, and then we'll let you go. Network attributes that you ultimately wind up with depend a lot on the metrics. Hopefully we've convinced you of that. Avoiding the subs or avoiding the night fighters may be good enough. You don't have to kill them all. And that's something that's not often noted with respect to the Bomber Command experience is, for the most part, they were about avoiding the German night defenses, not killing. The tempo of operations influences whether or not you exploit or disrupt the network. Virtual attrition is a big deal. It worked for the Allies in the Battle of the Atlantic. In some ways, sending our attack subs into the bastions could be viewed as a virtual attrition thing. You're taking advantage of the sensitivity of the other side to the potential for losses to impose operational costs on them. Competitions tend to accelerate, culminate, and then jump to some new mode. We've seen that. And then, in some cases, one side or the other is saved by the bell because the conflict ends for other reasons, you don't have to face something that could have been kind of catastrophic for you and eliminated your capability to spend so much time and money and effort developing. So, with that, I think we're done. Thanks for your patience in sitting through all of this. I know it was long, but there's a lot of data here and a lot of stuff to look into. So, yeah, go ahead.
You talked about the post-Cold War shift towards stealth.
Mm-hmm.
Does that explain why the Air Force seems to have abandoned the electronic jamming as even though they've gone to a joint solution with the Navy's planes, but it seems like they don't seem as interested in it.
I think that's you could certainly, make that argument. I would say that you're probably seeing a renaissance in interest in that area now, and that's likely to change for a lot. For much of the past couple of decades, there wasn't necessarily a demand for it, but as people begin to realize that we're likely to face more capable and competent adversaries going forward, I think you're going to see a kind of revival in that area. So,
one thing that that John was talking about is what's the next phase in the competition for air warfare versus air defense, and it's likely to be stealth plus electronic warfare. Mm-hmm. So stealth itself, just like we're seeing in the submarine case, big
Being
data,
quiet,
improved sensors are going to make it so that you can't make yourself stealthy enough to disappear because sensors and big data and computer processing is going to improve to the point where you're going to get found. And so the question is, I need stealth plus electronic warfare to be able to defeat that. And that's probably where that competition's going, even as the submarine undersea competition goes to a much more active environment.
So what I like to say is that just like we can't go back to building loud submarines just because there are other ways of detecting submarines, we can't go back to building airplanes with very large radar cross sections just because there's other ways of detecting airplanes that might overcome some of what we've done in terms of passive RF detection reduction or signature reduction. It's probably going to take that plus some of these other measures going forward. So.
Though, when we talk about mode shifts and we talk about networking, doesn't this suggest, for example, that that an adversary is going to go very hard on communications jamming, disrupting networks by any means whatsoever, and that would have very big effects not only on aircraft that we're building that are supposed, mm-hmm. To operate, that by default operate in networks, but also in terms of, using unmanned aircraft.
certainly in any battle network, the communication links are important. And I think to the extent that you want to be able to, you know, derive the benefits of the network or the battle network, you need to think very carefully about how you design the different parts of it. And you want it to degrade gracefully if you can. So go ahead.
And so one thing so you see in the ASW case, it's pretty much true that to do effective anti-submarine warfare and really try to kill a submarine, you've got to have a network. You've got to have multiple players involved just because of the geometries. And the guy with the best
sensors.
Right, he's going to be too big to be able to be an effective attack platform. And so what this means is it's going to create this competition for communication versus communication jamming. Because I think the idea that we're going to just turn off all the comms is not going to happen. I mean, there's lots of ways to circumvent enemy jamming approaches. Right. And just like you've seen in the previous cases. And so that's going to create a competition in the EM spectrum, in large part, for secure communication links. We're going to move toward things that are easier to, or harder to jam, but easier to maintain, like laser comms, or doing signals that hide in the noise. And so you're going to use processing on the front end and the back end to pull the signal out of what appears to be noise to the adversary. Right. So you're going to do lots of techniques that maintain your comms so you can keep up your network. But then that will drive you to designing your network in a way that maybe doesn't depend on high bandwidth comms.
Right.
So I want to make my network able to operate to some degree with less robust communication. So instead of the full motion video coming from the UAV that I'm using to actually steer my network around, I would instead rely on the UAV to do its own thing and then periodically communicate with me.
So thinking about the amount of data you need to move around the network and how fast you needed to move it around are important aspects of this. One thing that, I don't remember if we mentioned this or not in the submarine competition, but in addition to building submarines that could stay underwater longer and things like that, the Germans were prepared to move to a burst transmission in order to minimize their exposure when they communicated. And so thinking about things like that where, if I can just communicate a little bit of data over a small period of time, that gives the adversary less opportunity to interfere with that transmission. There may be, as Bryan said, lots of different ways to get things out. And if you don't have to move a lot of data because of the way that you've designed your kind of system of systems or whatever you want to call it, or your battle network, you're going to be more resilient against those types of intrusions. But this may be something that we've got to deal with one way or another, so it's important to think about.
The Swedes have talked about their fighter-to-fighter links and saying because they're identical systems talking to each other.
Yes.
The description was, well, it's like, it's like a pair of identical twins. They know what the other one's thinking. They don't really communicate that.
Right. So there may be things that we can do in terms of minimizing the amount of data we got to move. And then, as Bryan was saying, line of sight links and things like that are much more difficult to jam, particularly at distance. And there may be other ways of communicating that we haven't used in the past, like lasers and things like that. So,
I don't know if you've taken this into account, but of course it goes straight back to Arthur C. Clarke's science fiction story, Superiority, which is that you can cause virtual attrition by making the other guy's weapon systems so expensive that he can't afford as many of them.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
We succeeded in attriting the Dutch Air Force down from 85 to 37 aircraft.
Yeah, it's the cost imposition idea is something that's, again, closely related to this.
Right. So. Supposedly that was part of Weinberger's strategy.
Right. Yeah, certainly. If you come up with a way that the only way to defend against it is through a very expensive approach, then that competition is going to, and that gets to the idea of the competition culminating. So if you're the other guy and you're saying, the only way I'm going to keep up in this competition is by mounting a much more expensive effort to come up with a counter, then maybe I need to drive this and jump to a new competition.
Right.
And so the jumping to the new competition, if the threat, Weinberger was talking about, cruise missiles was an example of that. So with cruise missiles like the Tomahawk, you'd force the Soviets to have to defend almost their entire perimeter because you never know one of these, where's one of these things is going to come in, which would be very expensive. And so
because they fly low and I need radars
so
in line of sight.
You could, the way to jump out of that competition is to say, well, I'm not going to be in that competition anymore of radars trying to track cruise missiles coming in. I'm going to just work on jamming the comms that they would use to be able to keep the atomic strike network up, or I'm going to use a IR sensor that is going to track something at much longer ranges, and it's going to be much more efficient way of putting a perimeter around my territory or something like that.
And you can look at things, but you can also look at things like, as you described the Seawolf, I was thinking it's the F-22 of submarines.
Right.
But Seawolf and F-22 and Comanche and Zumwalt,
right,
in instances where we've somehow managed to impose cost imposition cost on ourselves.
Well, that's a likely result in all these competitions. You saw that the way it was going was each of those moves and counter moves probably almost inevitably resulted in a more expensive thing being the countermeasure, and so you're driving yourself into a more expensive approach. And so the first competitor that was able to jump to the new competition, so if the Germans had been able to field the Type 21 in any reasonable numbers, it would have been a little bit more expensive as a submarine, but the effort to counter it would have been enormously expensive for the Allies and would have proved to be a huge problem for them.
Because of the snorkeling,
because of the ability
to absorb the material,
because the ability to take itself out of the EM spectrum.
Yeah.
Right.
Was there snorkeling in the Bay of Escape time period?
No. So the Dutch had invented the snorkel in 1939, and they had it on some of their submarines. And it hadn't really, people knew about it, but it hadn't really been widespread use. The Germans didn't adopt it because of reliability concerns. They wanted something they could rely on. And Dönitz said, well, the type submarines that he had settled on were more reliable than the ones with the snorkels. But at the end of the war, that 1944, they came up with the Type 21 that combined the snorkel, a built-in radar warning receiver that you could actually use to see if somebody detecting me instead of trying to lash something up temporarily, which is what they had been doing, and then also the burst communication. So those three advancements were getting ready to be introduced with the Type 21. That would have meant we wouldn't have been able to use really any of our traditional EM spectrum capabilities, whether it was radar or signals intelligence, to try to find these guys, or avoid them, right? So finding them, that's how you avoid them. Yeah. You got to find out where they are, which would have been a huge problem. So the Allies were saved by the bell when the war ended before the Germans were able to field very many of those. But the reason the U.S. pursued passive sonar so aggressively at the end of the World War II was because these submarines were going to get in the hands of the Soviets. Because all those the Soviets got divvied up by the among the Allies, and so the Soviets got a bunch of those, and they said, well, the Soviets are going to deploy a bunch of these, we're going to have to deal with them, let's go pursue sonar very aggressively because we could find ourselves in a competition with the Soviets over the undersea domain. And they lucked out when it turned out that nuclear subs were very susceptible to passive sonar.